everybody. I had a bit of a busy day yesterday. I wasn't able to make an episode. It's the first I haven't made an episode in probably almost 2 months. There was a day 3 weeks ago or so where I didn't broadcast an episode, publish one, because I got published on my friend Ken McAuliffe's channel, the Jazz Vinyl High Audiophile. If you missed that episode, you should go to his channel and check it out. Hope you're all doing okay out there. These are crazy days. Today we're going to talk about one of my absolute favorite jazz musicians, Donald Byrd. I'm a big fan of Donald Byrd. He's a part of the Detroit School, along with Milt Jacksons and the Tommy Flanagans and the Kenny Burrells, and Paul Chambers, Kenny Clark. It's a long list, Pepper Adams, of guys from the Big D. Of course, I'm wearing the Big Toronto today, just getting, again, showing some love to my hometown, which is just down the 400 from Detroit, what, 3.5 hours? But Donald Byrd was born in Detroit December 9th, 1932. And his full name is Donaldson Toussaint Louverture Byrd II. If you didn't predict big things for your son by naming him Donaldson Toussaint Louverture Byrd II, I don't know what you could do better. Like, that's just saying my son's going to be something, somebody, the history books are going to have to make a note of. And they definitely need to. Byrd's an important cat in very many different eras of jazz. From the tail end of the bebop era to being one of the primary driving forces of the hard bop era to being one of the most prolific sidemen in jazz, playing on a lot of great records, some of which I'll show you, some of which I'll just read off to you for simplicity's sake. excuse me. And then he becomes a strong proponent of the fusion into the funk jazz era, and he crosses over almost completely into being a funk R&B jazz group with some of the great funk records in the 70s, Street Lady, Places and Spaces, Stepping Into Tomorrow. All three of those records are huge parts of my DJ sets. I love the tones and vibes and production of the Mizell Brothers, and we'll get into that stuff a little bit later here in this episode. But he starts off in 55 with this fantastic record here on Savoy. And it's quite the story. He went to Cass Technical College. He plays with Lionel Hampton's band for a while as a kid in high school still. He gets a bachelor at Wayne State University, which I believe is in Michigan. And then he gets a master's at Manhattan School of Music. And while still in Manhattan School of Music in 55, Clifford Brown passes, and Art Blakey has him step into that chair with what was really not the Jazz Messengers, but was the Jazz Messengers. And he's on that great first record on Columbia. He does a lot of stuff with Moby. We're going to get into all that. But this guy has a street credibility coupled with a music knowledge and competence that's not super common in this era of jazz, man. Today's jazz players, 70s, 80s jazz players, most of those guys were schooled and went to classes about jazz. When you're Louis Armstrong, there is no classes about jazz. You're writing the curriculum. And for most of the swing era and the bebop era, your education came on the bandstands, and you might have learned music theory in school, because more schools had music programs back in those days, even inner city black schools. Find an inner city black school now with a music program where their funding hasn't been cut so completely that their basketball rim doesn't have a string on it anymore, let alone the program to replace tubes for a reed section. Inner city schools were stripped of their music programs, one of the first things. And it's one of the real sad statements about this country is how our education system is falling into disarray and how we take the arts away from people so they can't voice and have an expression. And something's broken when your school systems don't function. And the inequality that exists between the private schools for the elite and the public schools for the masses and the public schools for the minorities, it's a caste system. We're living in an ancient stacked pyramid of class. And by no means is there any equality. But that being said, Byrd had a great education. He was very well informed, knew music theory, and he becomes one of the bright luminaries of jazz in the 60s and the 70s. And he ends up starting the Blackbirds, a bunch of his students in the 70s, and the Blackbirds make some of the great funk jazz records of that era. But let's dig in a little bit of his side work here. This record at Savoy, which is fantastic, which I showed you, has some great players on it. I believe Hank Jones is on it, Paul Chambers is on bass, Kenny Clark, Frank Foster's on the tenor sax. So it's a great little quintet. It's a tough record to find. It's Savoy 12032. And in the first 100 Savoys, he shows up on a lot of records. And I'm going to show those to you right now. This is Klook's Clique. And of course, Klook is Kenny Clark. That was his nickname. And what's weird is that Klook's Clique, that is not Klook on the cover. I'm not sure who that is on the cover, to be honest. John Laporta, I guess, is who it is. It's a sax player, and he's definitely got a sax, so... But this is a great record. It's funny how many mysteries I can find making these videos of things I still don't know. You know, you think you know some stuff, but... I did an episode on the Jones Brothers recently, where I speak about Hank Jones. And, of course, he's on both of these records and that were the trio with added members. This one's just called With Guests, and he's on a number of tracks on this. This is 12,053. This is 12,037, quartet and quintet. And highly recommend Hank Jones. And this early Savoy stuff is fantastic. Top Brass is a session kind of led by Ernie Wilkins, but it's really not. It's featuring five trumpets, Top Brass. And there's Donald Byrd right there on the end. Some great players here. Joe Wilder, Ernie Royal, Ray Copeland, and Idris Suleiman. And Hank Jones is on the piano, Wendell Marshall is on the bass, Kenny Clark is on the drums, Ernie Wilkins is conducting and arranging, so he's not even one of the trumpet players. I didn't realize that. See? I learn something new every day. Jazz has so much to teach us constantly. It keeps you humble, you know. This is 12017, and this is a very important record in the jazz canon. It's very early Savoy. And this is about the time where Savoy stops just releasing Roots library stuff. Old Parker, old Gillespie, old Bud Powell. Now all of a sudden they're releasing, not Bud Powell, I'm thinking Roost. They're releasing older sessions, Mary McPartland, just cats from the 40s and the early 50s. This is actually a record from 55, 12017, and it's got Cannonball Adderley's first appearance. It's one of Donald Byrd's first appearances. Horace Silver's on the piano, Nat Adderley is on the cornet, Paul Chambers and Jerome Richardson, and along with Kenny Clark, of course, on the drums. He's kind of given the leadership of this session, and Clark was a real innovator on the drums, and he was a real leader of a lot of those sessions, and he appears on untold number of Savoy sessions in this era. But and another important connection here is Byrd with Hank Mobley. Here's Mobley's two records that really weren't considered Mobley records upon first release. They were the Jazz Message Of, and Donald Byrd actually gets first billing on that one. But it's been considered a Mobley record now, and Mobley gets first billing on this one. But these are both great records. Blue note quality, hard bop, modern, on the edge of what was happening in 1956 and 1957. Great stuff. And he makes a number of more records with Mobley. I think 10, 12, all being told. This on Prestige. This is one of the first Blue Notes they do together. And he shows up with Mobley up into 67 on the Faraway Lands record. So he, off and on, is doing a lot of stuff with Mobley. And it's one of the great duos, I feel, of that era. In 56, I mentioned, he joins the Jazz Messengers, replacing Clifford Brown. And this is that record they do on Columbia. Hank Mobley, Art Blakey, Donald Byrd, Doug Watkins, and Horace Silver. Just an all-star group. One of the great records of 1956. It's just outstanding. Fiery, on the edge. This is where jazz is right now. You know, there's nothing really before this that sounds quite with the intensity and fire and passion and edges of militancy and social consciousness and resistance. This is where that kind of voice is starting to really rise up, that fist saying the status quo cannot remain. And this record is one of those statements. It leads to a lot of the rest of what happens, especially at Blue Note, but in the whole hard bop movement in the late 50s. And like I said, in some of those thrown together prestige sessions, you don't get that same feeling. You get some great playing, but you don't get quite the same feeling as you get from the fantastic Blue Note hard bop sessions of the late 50s. 1956, 55. Aside from doing that great session at Savoy and all that side work, he also finds the time to release three records on the Transition label. And that's the third one. That's the first one, actually. And Transition only has about a dozen releases. And these are great records. They're tough to come by. I bought mine out of Japan, because that was my only option. Doug Watkins is kind of a contemporary with him at Transition. I believe he's on all three of these records. Art Blakey shows up here as a thank you. Horace Silver as well. Hank Mobley. And then Joe Gordon also makes an appearance here, which kind of blows my mind every time I see it. I'm like, oh yeah, he's the trumpet player. And on this record, Blows on Beacon Hill. Oh, it's just a black back. I forgot about that. But this also has an outstanding lineup. And there's a number of the same cats. But there's BYRD. His tone has a great deal of brightness in it. Light. It doesn't have the forceful nature of an Armstrong or a Gillespie. It's not as virtuosistic. I don't know the word I'm looking for there. He's not the virtuoso of Clifford Brown with that fluidity, but he does tend to find the tonal melodic center most of the time and never gets too into the avant-garde. He's always about swinging and grooving and staying with the traditions of the music. And that's part of what makes him one of my favorite guys. He doesn't just jump into all the trends of the 60s and the 70s. He kind of stays in his lane. And even when he's making those great fusion funk records in the 70s, it still feels like Donald Byrd's being Donald Byrd. And he's still just expressing, just the groove has changed. The source of the groove has changed. And I really think that a lot of the things from the 70s and jazz are fails. And like I said, those three Mizell record brothers are just so good. So many great songs you can play at an event for people. And stepping into forget about it. So meanwhile, during 56, 57, he's doing a lot of side work. And we saw that he was doing stuff with the Savoy label. But he's also finding time to do stuff with Art Farmer, Three Trumpets, 70-92, Two Trumpets, Farmer and BYRD, 70-62. These are great records. It shows you the crossover nature of how these guys are appearing on each other's labels. This is also with Jackie McLean, Doug Watkins, Barry Harrison, Art Taylor, and then that combination of Donald BYRD and Jackie McLean also records together quite a bit in 56, 57, 58 with records like Lights Out, Presenting, 4, 5, and 6. So McLean and BYRD were quite related there for a few years in the late 50s. Being that he made that record with the Jazz Messengers at Columbia, it kind of opens the door for him to do another session at Columbia. And he starts this group called the Jazz Lab with the great Gigi Grice. And these guys end up making four records together on Columbia. Only two are on Columbia, sorry. this first one is a wonderful, nice old pressing of the nice six eye. I found this quite recently. I had a reissue for the longest time. It's a beautiful copy I found in a record store. Only like $30. I was like, heck yeah, I'll take that right now. He also does this one in 57 with Gigi at Columbia. And this has the singer Jackie Paris on it, which I thought was pretty interesting. I think he's only on a couple tracks, if I recall. And this is a big group. Jimmy Cleveland's on this, Julius Watkins, Sahib Shihab, Don Butterfield, Wynton Kelly, Wendell Marshall, Art Taylor. It's just a big group. A lot of big movements. It's the Jazz Lab, so obviously there's going to be a certain amount of pushing the envelope and experimenting and trying different sounds and even different instruments. This is actually giving credit to Gigi Grice, but it's a Jazz Lab quintet record, so it's really the same group. And there's Donald Byrd, and there's a young Donald Byrd right back there, and Art Taylor, Wendell Marshall, Wade Leggy, and Gigi Grice, of course. And we'll play a little bit of this too. This is an old Riverside stereo, and Hank Mulder was just coming in there. I hated to cut that off, but the Jazz Lab stuff all has interesting edges and colors to it. It's really fantastic. There's a lot of in-between shades and kind of interesting composition. You know, we're going to voice these instruments in part because Ellington said we can. Ellington opened the doors for all kinds of things, and jazz cats, especially with knowledge, we're always going to be cognizant of Ellington. He writes so much of the songbook. So when you want to compose, when you want to arrange, when you want to write jazz, you want to be impressing that guy. And remember, he's not by any means dead. Ellington's still very much alive. So throughout the 50s and 60s, he's bearing witness to all the things happening around jazz. This is a Jazz Lab reissue of the record I just showed you. I just figured I'd show you that in case you're in the record store and you see it. It's just a reissue of this. And if it's a good price and you don't have this, grab it. But if you have this, or if this is the one you want, you don't need that one. This is on the Jubilee label. And this is one of the few records of Jackie McLean's and a couple others that led me to Jubilee label. And this is was Herb Abramson, who was associated with the Erdogans at Atlantic, and they went their separate ways, so he starts Jubilee. And he does do some pretty solid jazz stuff here, especially once you get to about 57, 58. They knock out a couple dozen really, really important records in the canon. And then there's a lot of other interesting titles that aren't part of the canon that Jubilee issues, and also some Della Reese kind of R&B-ish jazz. But Jubilee's a fun label. I do an episode on them. Check that out, probably last month. This is on the Regent label, which is the subsidiary of Savoy. It's from 57. It's toward the end of his time with Savoy. And this is John Jenkins, Donald Byrd, Curtis Fuller, Flanagan, Watkins, and Taylor. So a lot of the same group that you see Byrd working with is present here. And a lot of those Detroit guys do work together off and on quite a lot. Including, of course, Pepper Adams, who Donald Byrd and Pepper Adams do a lot of recordings together, mostly under Donald Byrd's name, but some of it does. Pepper Adams doesn't get a lot of titles under his name, sadly. But is that not in? And then one of my favorite records, and I've shown this record in a numerous episodes because I just love it, is this Elmo Hope record, Informal Jazz. It was released as two tenors under Coltrane's name in the 60s, but this is its original viewing point, Elmo Hope, with just an incredible group. And Byrd's, of course, a big part of that session. But you can hear Byrd can cook. Like I said, he doesn't have the fire of a Hubbard or a Clifford or an Armstrong or Gillespie, but he certainly has more edge and more attack than your Miles Davis's, Art Farmer's, and Chet Baker's. You know, Bird's right there with Lee Morgan in terms of his brightness, his attack, his velocity, his comfort at tempo, his aggression. It's all kind of there, not quite on the level of those top guys. And by top, we're not talking skill. We're just talking tone. We're talking what forcing they're emoting, where they're coming from, you know? And Miles is always going to take that softer touch on the trumpet, as his Farmer. And Bird and Morgan are never going to be too soft, fuzzy, and warm, but they're not also going to be just blitzkrieg fast like Gillespie or Clifford. And Armstrong's brightness and forcefulness, not a lot of guys can play with the force of Louis Armstrong. You know, I feel like he must have burst mouthpieces at times. This is another record build Motor City Scene. I've given it leadership to Pepper Adams because he's first build, but Pepper Adams and Donald Byrd are kind of cross build there. And of course, Burrell, Flanagan, Paul Chambers, and Hey Lewis. And I think Hey Lewis was Lewis Hayes? Oh man, someone told me who that actually was. Now I can't recall. So that kind of gets us up to the point where he starts recording as a leader for Blue Note. And what's interesting here is that going back to 56, off to the races, and there he goes. Going back to 56, he's recording as a sideman at Blue Note with Mobley and McLean and other players. It's not until 59 where his contracts free him up to record as a leader for Alfred Lion and Blue Note. This is his debut with Jackie McLean, Pepper Adams, Sam Jones, Art Taylor, and Wynton Kelly. And of course, he's recording with Jackie at the same time. He and Pepper Adams have that long relationship with the guy Say, and it's a great rhythm section. Him and Art Taylor have played together quite a lot. I'm not sure if he played with Wynton and Sam before this, but they've almost certainly jammed together, if not recorded. Fantastic stuff. His second record of Blue Note is Bird in Hand. We're going to take a little peek at this one as well. And there's that trademark groove that Donald Byrd will never abandon. Like, this could be places and spaces I've been. Like, and always, even on the most electric, funky stuff, is playing some incredible trumpet. Again with Pepper Adams. There he is right there. The baritone sax is a great sound, man. Charlie Rouse is on this, Walter Davis, Sam Jones, and Art Taylor. So that looks like that's kind of becoming his rhythm section. This is Donald Byrd, Fuego. We're talking 4026. His first one was 4007, so late 58, early 59, when they switched to 4000, and that's the seventh one. And this one was 4019. And so 4026, 20 records later, he's got three records of the next 20 records Blue Note does. This is with Lex Humphreys, Doug Watkins, Duke Pearson, who I love dearly, and Jackie McLean. That's a great record. This is Duke Pearson, Bird in Flight, and Mobley returns the favor and records on this session with him. There's Bird's tone, though. It's just a wonderful tone. Thank you. Beautiful. A lot of brightness, a lot of clarity in his tone. Some trumpet players tend to be muddy and don't enunciate cleanly each syllable. And Clifford Brown is, of course, the great enunciator. And Donald Byrd definitely is no slouch either in that department. I think he's probably a notch above Morgan in that department. He's got a working group going by this point. These are 40-61, 40-60. This is at the half note. Pepper Adams, Duke Pearson, Lamont Jackson, and Lex Humphreys. And these are great live cooking session records. Hard driving Blue Note. Fantastic part of the Blue Note canon. And then I want to show you a few more records as a sideman here. I'll let him play in the background. He does, in the late 50s, 57, 58, three records with Red Garland. This is All Morning Long. I just did an episode on Red Garland if you want to dig deeper and know what I'm talking about here. But Garland, most of his stuff is trios, but he does three quintet records with Donald Byrd and John Coltrane. Soul Junction, this one, and High Pressure Links, the other one. And great album cover. And then this one ties in All Morning Long, title-wise, to a couple records that have been given leadership to Kenny Burrell, but were really kind of prestige jam records. Donald Byrd, Jerome Richardson, Kenny Burrell, All Night Long, and then here's All Day Long. And then he does Burrell a favor and plays with them on this record with Jimmy Rainey, two guitars, with Byrd, McLean, Waldron, Watkins, and Taylor. So there's a lot of crossover here between Prestige, Riverside, that short-lived Transition label, even Savoy. They're all kind of exchanging sessions and sidemen. This is Catwalk, once again with Pepper Adams, Duke Pearson, Layman Jackson, and Philly Joe Jones shows up on this one. I'll play a little bit of this one. Swing. Right off the bat, it's going to have that pop and swing. You know, let's keep it snapping. I feel like Donald Byrd's records, if you had a park with a bunch of old black men playing chess at those little chess park tables, you put on some Donald Byrd, they're going to be like, okay, son, well done. They ain't going to want to hear none of that odd stuff, but they want to hear some Donald Byrd. Royal Flush, again with Pepper Adams, this is a great record. Herbie Hancock shows up here. He does do a few records with Hancock as well. I think Point of View with one of them. Butch Warren, Billy Higgins. This is 4101. The H just means it's a stereo pressing. But so we're 4101 now, probably 1960, maybe 61. Another great album cover. This is Free Form, Donald Byrd, and this is with Wayne Shorter, Herbie Hancock, Butch Warren, and Billy Higgins. And this is him kind of skirting with some edge a little bit more than he normally would. It was just kind of what was happening in the times. But you can see that even still right off the bat has that familiar groove. I remember there being something that was a little more out. That's beautiful though. Beautiful stuff. Pentecostal feeling, Nightflower, Nine-Eye. And there's no question that the church was very interwoven with the fabric of the black community. This is A New Perspective, Donald Byrd Band and Voices. And so there's some interesting vocal passages on this. A great album cover with the car. He, like Jimmy Smith and others, were known for loving their automobiles. And I had a little flash to the So here you got a wonderful Cristo Redentor, is it? Redentor? Probably Christ the Redeemer, I'm guessing that means, probably in Latin. Burrell, Mobley. Donald Best is on the vibes. Hancock, Warren, and Humphreys. Voices directed by Coleridge Perkinson. Arrangements by Duke Pearson. It's beautiful. It's moody. It's contemplative. It's got elements of humanity and mortality in it, which we all have to skirt with and flirt with at times. I'm Trying to Get Home kind of follows that same theme. It's got the church, and it's got the voices in it. And this was an interesting phase for Donald, and one that he recognizes the value and the importance of the Black church and how much it shaped and informed the music. This is Bird, Steady Turntine, Hancock, Grant Green, Freddie Roach, Bob Cranshaw, Grady Tate, and then it's got just a huge section with trumpets, Ernie Royal, Snooky Young, Jimmy Owens, Clark Terry, a big bone section with Jimmy Cleveland, Benny Powell, Harry Coker, and J.J. Johnson. That's his royalty. We just did a cool episode on the trombone players. French horns, tuba, Don Butterfield. It's interesting voices as well. So Bird does some pretty interesting stuff here that's going to push some of the boundaries. But at the same time, Ellington's doing sacred music and sacred concerts, you know? And so you can be innovative to a degree in jazz, but there's a good chance Ellington beats you to it. You know, even Mingus, Monk, all these guys, man, if you have composition whatsoever, I mean, if you're not just a blues player, if you do some composing and arranging, there's a real good chance that what you do is going to have some Ellington influence in it. You know, it's just inescapable. And he did everything. You know, it wasn't like Ellington just did this one thing. Ellington did everything. And none of it was really boxed in by labels or time frame or even the length of recordings. Ellington just pushed all the limits. And when you write 2,500 pieces of music, you're going to cover some ground. This is Mustang. There's one of the Boogaloo tracks here for Balloon Out is on this record. And it's got that kind of a feel going on. Boogaloo was having pretty good success at Blue Note. This is Blackjack, Sonny Red, Hank Mobley, Cedar Walton. Another great record. It's really an impressive canon that Donald Byrd puts together here. You know, it's such a broad part of the jazz canon. His work is pretty much all canonized, and the great disciples. You know, makes him one of the great innovators and voices of this music. This is Slow Drag. And by now we're talking 42.92. The sale to Liberty has happened. The covers kind of change. The fonts kind of change. The side groups kind of change. Blue Note, after the sale, is still a fine jazz label. But there's obviously changes afoot almost immediately. I've started some DJ sets with this track. Slow, smoky, moody. It's got a pocket to it. Telling you a story. See what I'm saying? And this is kind of a slow boogaloo. Sonny Red, Cedar Walton, Walter Booker, Billy Higgins. I love this track. It's actually a longer track. I think it stretches out to 8 or 9 minutes. It's beautiful. it's my headspace for sure. Slanky, nice groove. This is Fancy Free from 1969. By now he's starting to play with different guys: Frank Foster, Lou Tobacco, Julian Priester, Duke Pearson, Roland Wilson, Jimmy Ponder, Joe Chambers, Nat Bettis, and John Robinson. And that's part of the change going away from Blue Note, is that the stable of artists just changes. And on top of that, Liberty is going to bring some of their house musicians, players, studio guys into these sessions as well. And they're just going to have access to a whole field of musicians that have recorded for their labels. And now Blue Note's just part of that family. Again, the feel here is automatically quite different. But you're starting to change towards elements of fusion. The congas and the percussion in there, some Latin feel, electric pianos going on, there might be an electric bass player going on. So this is Bitches Brew in a Silent Way era, but for the most part I'll take this. There's more meat to it than Silent Way, and not the fighting for air claustrophobia of Bitches Brew. This is a great record, Electric Bird. I think it's 1970. Great stuff. Also on 8-track. I'm old enough to remember the 8-tracks. They sucked. You didn't have an 8-track very long before that shit got eaten. A lot of the same musicians that were on the last one. Pepper Adams reappears here, though. That's kind of cool. Frank Foster, Ron Carter, Mickey Roker. But yeah, we got electric bass, electric piano, quite a big horn section, electric guitar, Wally Richardson. There's some elements of Bitches Brew right there, even. That kind of synthetic calling into the wilderness feel. Desperation. But this is probably a little more centered melodically, actually. And that's more funk and more groove and more spatial allowance than Bitches Brew ever allows. The density of Brew is so thick. And like, that's got solid. Solid. So Electric Bird is great stuff. There's a record here called Ethiopia and Kofi. And I don't actually have those two. They're right in that middle period where I don't like that stuff quite as much as like the early trad stuff and the later funk stuff. I need to get them both, and I will at some point. There's also a record that a Tone Poet put out, Chant, which I need to find from like 61. This is Street Lady, and this is the beginning of him really kind of changing his directions. And he's launched the Blackbirds at this point as well. And there's a real changing of the guard. If you just watch my episode on the hip-hop versus the jazz, you'll hear how these records that we're about to talk about were all borrowed by hip-hop. And if you go through Blackbird, if you go through Places and Spaces, Domino, by the way, is one of the great songs ever, Stepping Into Tomorrow, there's hip-hop songs hiding everywhere on these records. And what that does, especially if you come from hip-hop, it's a bit like watching a TV show with an actor you love. There's already a bit of a comfort there. People, when they go to New York, often feel strangely comfortable and at home, and the place seems strangely familiar to us. And that's partly because we've seen New York featured so much, so often, in movies and TV, that we kind of recognize it. And so, if you're a hip-hop kid, and you're coming to an old Blue Note record, and you put on some Donald Byrd, and you hear a song that was sampled by a hip-hop group you like, you might not even connect it immediately, but it's gonna have a familiar, you're like, oh. I swear there's been times I groove to a record for 10 listens, and then all of a sudden I was like, oh shoot, no wonder I like this, this is that. Of course. You know, so it takes sometimes a little sinking in. Wind Parade. These records are just funky spatial masterpieces, great production. Some interesting strings the Mizell brothers put in there. This has been sampled and used, that breakbeat's been used a lot. And this is just a great song. I love Domino. This is just such a great song. Pretty Lady, Dry Your Eyes. Yeah. That's it. That's what we need. You know, I got tacos. I don't want to get fucking, you know what I'm saying? But, that's fun stuff. He does. This is the greatest hits on Blue Note. And honestly, if you're ever out and about in a record store and you see this Blue Note greatest hits, great place to start with Donald Byrd. As a DJ, I just had that in my crate forever. Here he's on Electra now, getting the late 70s, Donald Byrd 125th Street. I'm not as familiar with this late stuff. Thank you for fucking up my life. Funking up my life, sorry. Donald Byrd, again, I think that's on Electra, it is. And then, this is a record that comes out on Verve, like, in 63. And I should have put it in there earlier, I forgot about it. But it's a interesting record. He doesn't really fit in much with the Verve artist rosters. And I can't remember what brought him over here for this. He does a great version of Cantaloupe Island here, though, I remember that. And Hancock, Jimmy Heath, Kenny Burrell, Crenshaw, Grady Tate. 1964, Rudy Van Gelder. It's interesting how this ends up here on Verve. But it's solid, solid stuff. I wonder why. I'd like to know, anyone knows why this ended up on Verve. Please let me know. And then the last record I want to show you here is also from the early 60s, maybe late 60s actually. But it's got Curtis Fuller, Bill Evans, Paul Chambers, Philly Joe Jones. This is on Inner City label, Taking Care of Business. This is Donald Byrd, Booker Little, The Third World. And it's probably 63, 64 because Booker Little doesn't live much long past that, so. Anyway, that covers the great Donald Byrd. Like I said, he's one of the true leaders of this music. He just records with everybody from this era, from the bebop era, all the Savoy greats, the Prestige guys, Pepper Adams, Riverside, and then the Mobley Blue Note, Jackie McLean, Horace Silver, Art Blakey connections, and then all the way through his solo career into the 70s. He's one of the luminaries of jazz, one of the great teachers of jazz, one of the great ambassadors of this music, of this art form, the black community. He was a brilliant leader, brilliant man. I've met a few of his relatives, actually, from Detroit, and honored to say that I've met them, and I have nothing but high praise for Donald Byrd. He's really one of the greats, and to me, his star should be even brighter in the jazz constellations than it is. And it's pretty bright. It's pretty luminous. But there's other trumpet players out there who get a whole lot more love, who, to me, have contributed far less. So, appreciate you all. Y'all be safe out there. Any questions, let me know. Dig Donald Byrd. Buy them when you see them. You can't really go wrong with a Donald Byrd purchase. You can't. Be safe out there. Peace.